Welcome to the Zohar class. The portion of this week is Mishpatim, b'mani, in the meaning of judgment, justice, judging, court system. It's covering the whole subject of justice. We are in a period of time, we are in the last period of the Shovavim. There were 6 weeks that started in Shemot, and this is the last portion. And in these 6 weeks, we learn about how to change our belief system. We learn how to change ourselves, our belief system. We had amazing 5 classes. This is going to be also the best, very good class also. I highly recommend. Go back and over, listen to the classes we had for the 5 weeks. I believe they were the best classes since we started. It's about the belief system, changing to better. How can I bring healing to my life? How can I become a better person? It was wonderful lessons, and this one is going to top it up. And from next week, we're going to start preparing for Purim and Passover. So the Shovavim was the 6 weeks that we have these strange ideas, strange belief system. Somebody from outside controlling my mind doesn't let me do the right thing. Doesn't let me to reach my potential. And this week, Mishpatim is about judgment. If you are going to read from the Torah a few sections, is all talking about some strange laws, strange consequences. The famous tooth for a tooth, eye for an eye is in this section. If you read from the Torah, section 12, anyone who strikes a man and kills him shall surely be put to death. Anyone who kidnaps another and either sells him or steals him when he is caught must surely be put to death. And then we have the section of eye for an eye. It says an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, hand for a hand, foot for a foot, burn for a burn, wound for a wound, and bruise for a bruise. I mean, the Torah is a blueprint of the universe. It's trying to teach us, you know, I am for an eye, what does it have to do with me? There is another section. If a man uncovers a pit or digs a pit and fails to cover it, and an ox or a donkey falls into it, the owner of the pit must pay for the loss. He must pay its owner, and the dead animal will be his. So this portion is all about laws and punishments between people, animals. What it have to do with us? You know, what is it to teach me? Well, how can I become a better person learning this section? Without Zohar, without Kabbalah, there is no way to understand this. The Zohar explains that it's all about reincarnation. The whole section of Mishpatim, judgment, have to do with reincarnation. Tanasuch Ru in Hebrew, Gilgul Neshamot. Tonight we're going to study about reincarnation, but we're not going to study reincarnation for what is reincarnation. We're going to study it for the purpose of my belief system to have a healthier, better life. We don't want to get the knowledge of what is reincarnation. We want to use it as a tool. So we're going to become better people, more successful, healthier and happier. You know, reincarnation have to do with our past. Who we are now is directly connected to who we are in the past. You know, we walk into a room and we know that room is familiar to us. We see a person, automatically we dislike him. We see some other person, automatically we fall in love with him, but for no reason. There is strong attraction, you know, this amazing attraction to a different person. There is unfair situations in our life. There is sicknesses in our life that there is no explanation. There is fears in our life that we cannot explain. Some people are afraid of heights. Some people are afraid of darkness. Some people are afraid of the ocean for no reason. Pain. We have this pain, unreasonable, unexplainable pain. There are people that are handicapped, you know. Where is it coming from? Why? We learned in the last classes, if you remember, there is no luck. We don't believe in luck. There is no lucky and unlucky. There is a reason behind everything. Some people, they remember, they can recognize something from the past. Some people, they don't recognize anything from the past. Some people like us, like spirituality, because we are old soul. Older souls, they are attracted to spirituality. Younger souls, they laugh at the Torah, they having fun, they're partying, you know, they're after pleasures that are younger souls. And whoever is in your life, whoever is in your life have to do with your past life also. Whoever is in this class, whoever in this kenisa, whoever is in your own family, have connection with your past. There is no random. There is no randomness. So, anything in our life, all the fears, all the health issues, all the financial issues, all the relationship issues, whatever is in our life is coming from our past. There is no accident, there is no unluckiness, there is no randomness. You know, if you are in this class, if you are following these classes, we are here to change our belief system. Whatever chaos is in our life is because we believe in randomness. Because we believe unlucky or lucky. There is no such a thing. We are here to change our belief system into there is a reason for everything, everybody, every situation, every challenge, every discomfort, every, God forbid, disease. Everything has to do with our past life. Some of the issues can go back as much as Adam and Eve. We still may be correcting something from Adam and Eve. And some of the issues that we created in our own past life. And unfortunately, by not having this wisdom, we are creating issues for our future in this life and in the next lifetime also. So, the belief system I want you to have, stop believing in a randomness and accident and I'm unlucky and I'm a victim and they did it to me and it's somebody else's fault, it's my parents. No, tonight we're going to put end to all that blaming. We are responsible for A to Z from everything in our life. And it's coming back from the past life. Some people are cleansing a huge issue from maybe from Adam and Eve. So they have a huge challenge. Some people, you know, we look at them, maybe they have a lot of ego, they're in a leadership position, they're changing the life of a country maybe even. So these people, they have a huge task to cleanse something. Maybe back from Adam and Eve. So, as small as it could be, or as huge it could be, it's all have to do with the past. And these people, they can handle it. It's a known fact. It's a known fact. The bigger the issue is, the bigger your soul is, the stronger your potential is. If you're dealing with a huge chaos, it's because you have a huge potential, you have a huge soul. You took upon yourself, because you can handle this task, to cleanse it, to purify it. So, with the help of the Zohar, we're going to try to decode, try to understand what is this concept of a mishpatim, judgment, and what it has to do with reincarnation. Again, this chaos or this challenge can go back 1,000 years ago from now, 2,000 years from now. So, I have to face it as an opportunity, as a challenge, or something I've done before and I need to correct it now. Not to be sorry about it, not to be worried about it, not to be afraid of it, not to blame anybody, not to become a victim. Become a victim is a nice word to say, but it's a very complicated issue. Feeling victim is like I done something wrong and there is no more purpose in my life. Are you kidding me? You know, every moment of a life is a new opportunity, is a new way, new opportunity to shine a light. Whatever happened 1 minute ago is gone. You know, if I miss the opportunity, that's fine. There is another one coming up. But falling into the victim consciousness, I don't see the future, I don't see the light, I don't see a better time coming up, that's totally wrong. So, we're trying to eliminate this victim consciousness by taking responsibility that it was my wrongdoing, it was my issue, I took upon myself a huge task to correct for humanity. So, the more we believe that there is an order in this life, the easier our life is going to go on. If I believe in randomness, my life is going to be full of chaos. It's a very simple formula. If you believe in randomness, your life is going to be full of chaos. If you believe in cause and effect, there is an order, then your life is going to have order. I'll give you an example. You know, when we drive, we stop for a red light. We wake up in the morning, I know I have a job to do. I have to pay my taxes. I don't go to the street naked, I dress up, I put on a libouche. So, there is an order in my physical life. There is also order in my spiritual life. If I run a traffic light, if I don't pay my taxes, if I don't obey the laws, so my life is going to be full of chaos, right? So the same thing with spirituality. If I believe in randomness, oh, I fell from the sky and you know somebody gave me this challenge, or my car got flat tire randomness, then my life is going to be full of chaos. But if I believe in a cause and effect, if I believe there is an order, then my life is going to have order also. It's a huge subject. I really hope that I'm really clear about it. If I believe, you know, in if I'm a smart person and I'm modern and I'm educated, I don't believe in spirituality, then, you know, life is going to be full of chaos. In order to bring order. Order means healing, happiness, success, good relationships. I have to bring order to my consciousness. I'm not here by accident. I'm not here randomly. Whoever my parents are, whoever my friends are, whatever my job is, my sign, my Torah portion that I say, is not a random, it's not an accident. It's by design for you to fulfill a purpose, to do your job, to do some kind of a correction. So studying of reincarnation is not to add to your knowledge, it's for the purpose of eliminating the belief system of the randomness. So they said, you know, reincarnation is a huge part of Kabbalah. Without reincarnation, there is no Kabbalah. There is no study of Kabbalah. There is no study of the Torah. So it's a huge subject, because without it, you know, there's going to be chaos in our life. You see, spirituality, Judaism, is everything by order. We have days, we have months, we have holidays, we have time to for connections, we have certain mitzvah to do. And when there is order in my life, I'm in control. You know, but if I break the law of the my city, of my country, they're going to take me to jail. I'm not in control anymore. So, if I believe that there is a cause and effect, there is a reason for everything and everybody and all the situations, 24/7, all my life, there's a reason behind everything. Whoever I know, whoever I meet, if I know there is a reason, that there is an order, then I'm going to be in control of my life. I'm not going to be controlled by this randomness. Very, very, very spiritual people, they believe even that the leaf doesn't fall for no reason. We're still far away from that point, but we're going to get there. Let's read from the Zohar. We are in book number 10, page 275. Book number 10, page 275, section 1. It's going to summarize what I just explained. We're going to read this section for the connection.
What's the page number again?
275. So we're going to mark this page. Each time I believe something random happened to my life, each time for some reason I think, you know, there was an accident, you know, or I feel like a victim, I open this page, I remember this class, that there was I'm the cause, I'm cleansing something from my past life. Befami.
Sorry, I had a question. Last night, also in the meeting, someone asked, who came from that board?
After class. Pass. Again, we mark this page. Each time I fall into this victim consciousness, I start blaming others. I fall into this chaos and randomness. I'm going to recite this section, and it's going to help me to change my belief system from randomness to order. We're going to read the English very fast. Rabbi Shimon says that the title verse refers to the rules concerning reincarnations, the judgment of the soul that are to be sentenced according to their punishable act. Patach Rabbi Shimon va'amar, ve'ela mishpatim asher tasim lifnehem, tirgum, ve'alin diena de די תסדר קדמיהון, אלין אינן סידורין, דה גלגולה דינין דה נשמתין, דה אתנדו כל חד וחד לקבל עונשיה. רבי שמעון open with the words, and there are the judgments which you shall set before them. Also in the Aramaic translation it speaks of judgments. These are the rules concerning reincarnation, namely the judgment of the soul that incarnate again in the world to be sentenced, each according to his punishable act. We're going to go to the next page, 276, very fast. I'm going to read the top part. Rabbi Shimon continues by saying that unperfected souls are forced to be born again until they have finished correcting the six levels of Chesed, Gevurah, Tiferet, Netzach, Hod, and Yesod. Please read the rest at home, it's very interesting. We're going to go down to the English part, section number 2, where it starts with either. 1, 2, 3, 4. The fifth sentence in English starts with either. Everybody there?
Yes.
either because of sins or because of it had not completely fulfilled during its lifetime the Torah and the precepts. What the Torah explains is, you know, they use the word punishment. We don't, in our system, there is no punishment. We don't believe in punishment. There is no punishment. What there is the missed opportunity to create light. ما توی دنیا اسپریچوالیتی مجازات نداریم، پانیشمنت نداریم. تنها چیزی که هست که فرصتی داشتیم که نور ایجاد بکنیم ولی نور را ایجاد نکرد. اصلا این کانسپت گناه و پانیشمنت it doesn't exist. You either create light or you don't create light. Like the Zohar says, we come here, the Torah says, talking about six times coming and going. We are here to create chesed, to practice love and understanding and compassion. It's not talking about killing somebody, the Zohar, or hurting somebody. It's talking about gevura, how much brave you were to stop your negativity. Tiferet, how much balance you had in your life. How much balance you bring to other people's life. How good looking you were, not in a physicality, good looking of your soul. Netzach, how victorious you were in your life. Hod, how much shalom, how much kohen, Hod is kohen gadol. Did you acted like a kohen during your lifetime? Kohen is not just a name, it's a title. We all have to act like a kohen. Kohen's job is to bring healing to the mind and the soul of other people. Kohen's job is not just come on Shabbat and bless other people. All of us, Kohanim in special, we have to bring healing to the mind and body of other people. That's Kohen's job is. And Yesod, how much good you did in your life, how much Torah you study in your life, like this section says. So, there is a diamond. What the Zohar says, our soul is like a diamond, like a rough diamond. Some part of it is clear, some cleanse, some part of it is not, it's dark, it's black. So our job is to cleanse, to clean, to purify, to shine that part of our soul that is not shining. So forget about punishment. You know, it's if there is a chaos in my life right now, it's not about punishment. I had the opportunity to create light in my past lifetime. I didn't do it. I missed the opportunity, maybe for selfish reason or for whatever reason. Now I have a chance to correct it. And whoever is in my life, whatever scenario, whatever issues, whatever challenges, whatever obstacles in my life, is to shine that diamond again, to make it pure 100%. You know, we want so much. We want money, we want wealth, we want health, we want success, we are looking for soulmates, we are looking for happiness. It's not going to come from the outside. If you have this illusion that it's going to come from outside, it's not coming from the outside. It's all coming from the inside. We're going to read the section. Whoever listened to last year's class, I know you did. There's a section in the Torah is amazing. We're going to read it. Remind me to read that section and remind me to explain the Anabekoah. So, whatever we want, whatever you're looking for, whatever you're praying for, whatever you're investing in it, it's not going to come from the outside. It's going to come from the inside. Is the soul, is this diamond? This diamond gonna bring you health. This soul gonna bring you happiness. This soul gonna attract your soulmate to yourself. You know, we keep dating, we keep going out. It's not out there, it's inside here. When it's pure, when it's cleansed, when it's beautiful, when it's activated, when it's you're in partnership with him. It's gonna be gonna read it. It's gonna take it to wonderful places. You know, let's read it right now. So again, we have to cleanse this diamond. We have to cleanse this soul. He or she is the answer to all my prayers. Is the answer to whatever I want. You know, I have very interesting conversation with you guys. Last week we talked about sick person, that horrible disease, and you know nobody can do anything for them. But they change their consciousness. The psychologists call it be positive, but it is part of it. Changing consciousness, changing belief system, praying, connecting, you know, changing your lifestyle, changing your consciousness, save people from these horrible diseases. Who does it? It's not the doctors, it's not the medicines, it's the soul from the inside. So, whatever we're praying for, we raise our hand, you know, we do so much to bring goodness from outside, but it's from the inside. And we're going to learn how to do it. You cleanse yourself, you stop all the negativities. I talk to you guys, changing is very difficult. It's difficult for me to change. And we don't change. For the class, yeah, it sounds wonderful. Tomorrow we're back to who we were. We don't change. I know you guys, I know myself, and I know humanity. Changing is very difficult. So, whatever we invest in these classes is to change ourselves, you know. Tomorrow I'm chasing the money, I'm chasing the health, I'm chasing my soulmate, but over and over, we learn from the Torah, we learn from the Zohar, the Kabbalah. It's cleansing yourself, purifying yourself, educate yourself, add wisdom, add chokmah. I'm not telling you about the religious way, start doing rituals and praying, no. Wisdom, consciousness, understanding, knowledge, awareness, positivity. And we're going to learn how else. What else? So, when I purify this soul, when I'm in partnership with Him, He's going to give me everything. So, in the Torah, on the sixth Aliyah, this Shabbat, it's, you know, usually you have to decode the Torah. This Shish Shabbat, you don't need to decode it. It's give it to you. After all the judgments, after all the cleansing, after all the purification, after all the tooth after tooth, hand after hand, what the Torah gives you, it's amazing. And it's talking about your soul. I'm going to read it in English.
What page?
No, that's not the Zohar, that's the Torah. So again, I'm reading the section from the Torah. It tells you when you cleanse, purify, when you shine this diamond, when you realize that your issues is you're responsible for it, you choose it or you cause it, and I'm here not here to fix it. When you cleanse this soul, this is the answer the Torah gives us, the sixth Aliyah. Here I am sending an angel. It's talking about the soul, your soul, that after you awaken it, after you recognize your soul. There are still people that they don't believe even there is a soul. So if the belief system is not right, how do you expect to have order in your life? So, we believe in a soul, we believe in reincarnation, and this is the gift we're going to get. Here I am, sending an angel, that's your soul, ahead of you, to guard you along the way, and to bring you to the place I have prepared. Pay attention to him, and listen to what he says. Do not rebel against him. He will not forgive you, your rebellion, since my name is in him. If you listen carefully to what he says and do all that I say, I will be an enemy to your enemies and will oppose those who oppose you. Worship the Lord, your God, and his blessing will be on your food, on your water. I will take away sickness from among you. This is the Torah. So, where are we looking for healing? Where are we looking for happiness? Out there? No, it's inside here. We are so busy with our life. We are so busy with our life that we forget our purpose. Our purpose is to cleanse, to fix this soul that is carrying a baggage from the past life. You know, we have a court system in the physical world, and we also have a court system in the spiritual world. They're identical. They're mirrored one to each other. There is nothing in the physical world that doesn't exist in the spiritual world. What the court system do? Somebody break the law, they give them time. They put them in jail. They give them a punishment. How do you call, in English or in the United States, how do they call jail? Correction facility, right? They put a person in a correction facility. We've done something in the past, maybe 1,000 years ago, maybe 200 years ago, maybe we are part of Adam Rishon. We've done something, there is a judgment, there was a judge that gave us a judgment, gave us a time to correct, correction facility. This body, my life, is the correction facility. I'm here to correct what I've done. There is no accidents, no randomness, poor me, why me? That doesn't exist. Your response, there was a judgment, and you have to correct it. You're in a correction facility. Either we correct it in a short time, you know, in a good behavior, they send you home early, right? And if you keep breaking the law in the jail, they extend your sentence. So they give us a sentence. I don't know, you know, maybe I'm here to correct one thing, maybe I'm here to correct 100 things. But it's obvious, it's on my plate, I don't have to look for it. So they give me a sentence, the sooner I'm correcting it, I'm home free. The chaos gonna leave my life. The chaos that I think is a chaos, or the misfortune, or the unfair, that I think is going to go away. You don't want to fix it, you don't want to correct it, and you want to add to it by complaining and crying and causing more issues. So they're going to extend your correction. Maybe I'm going to have to come back 10 more times until, you know, this issue is going to be over. So it's a beautiful, whatever happened in our court system is exactly happening in a spiritual court system. We are here in a correction facility to correct what we've done in the past life. There is a very famous story, most of you know it, I don't know if I should repeat it or not. There is a story that the students in the Zohar go to his teacher and says, this life is not unfair. So one guy rich, one guy poor, one guy sick, one guy healthy. He tells, it's not fair. This life is not fair. The teachers tell him, go to a park and look at that tree and come and tell me what happened. So the student go to the park, he's looking at the tree. There was a man with a bag full of money passing by. He was tired. You know the story, right? So he said, let me take a rest under the tree. He falls asleep, he wake up, he leaves, he forget the bag of money under the tree. Another guy passed by, he sees a bag of money, he grabs it and he takes it and he leaves. A third person comes back and also tired and sit down under the tree to rest. The first guy, he remember he forgot his money, he's going back to the tree. He sees the third guy, he tells him, give me my money. He says, what money? What are you talking about? I don't owe you any money. So the first guy, he beat him, he hurt him, he punched him, put him against the tree, and he leaves. The student goes back and says, my teacher is out of his mind, you know. Instead of giving me the answer, he got me even confused. So he goes back to his teacher. The teacher says, let me explain it to you. The first guy stole money from the second guy in the past life. It's not a story, please. I'm not here to entertain you. I'm here to tell you what's going on in your life. He says the first guy, he owed money to the second guy. He did a business deal, he stole his money. Now in this lifetime, he have to pay him, give him his money back. He says, what about the third guy? Why he got beat up? He said he was the judge, that he knew the truth, but he still ruled for the thief. And now he gets to get beat up. So, again, I'm repeating myself, and I hate to do it, but I want to make the point. If you believe in randomness, your life is going to be full of chaos. If you believe that there is a cause and effect, there was a cause in a past lifetime, and now is the effect, and I have to correct it. And I don't want to carry it for another lifetime, so I want to correct it now. I want to be home free. I don't want to extend my correction facility. There is three rules how we can, I can achieve that change. How can I start practicing order, cause and effect? See everybody, everything in my life as the effect of my past lifetime. And this cleansing is not easy. I know it's not easy. But you have to be aware 24/7, all the time. We get angry, we get frustrated, we get annoyed, we get nervous, we start shaking, we are right, we want to be right all the time, we want to be, I don't know, we want to be, we are so strict and we are so stubborn. They said one of the tallest trees is the palm trees. Why is the tallest tree? Because it bends. You know, it bends. If you're so tough, if you're so strict, I know we go to school and I know we live in a country with law and order, but you don't have to be so strict about everything. You know, let it go. It's okay. You know, you're in a position to, I don't know, to collect money for the Kenisa. Some guy doesn't pay. Somebody, I don't know, whatever. It's okay. It's no big deal. The poison, the judgment, the uncomfort, the worriness, the struggle, the being annoyed, is the damage is 1,000 times more than one itsy bitsy issue that nobody gonna even remember the next day. So if I'm judged, if I react, if I'm worried, if I'm concerned, if I don't wanna bend, we had a class that it's okay to break the rules. You can break a lot of rules, but only for the purpose of creating light, not for the selfishness. You can break any rules you want, but as long as it's for the purpose of light, to creating light. So don't be so rigid, don't be so strict that everything has to be by the law, everything has to be perfect, everything has to be right in my itsy-bitsy conscience. Let go, it's okay. So all this judging and all this worriness is add to our sentence. It doesn't fix the issue. Inject love, inject compassion, inject understanding. Nobody gonna take you responsible for anything. After all, whatever we do in our life, we are the beneficiary of it. If I'm so worried about my business or for my job or for my boss, they give me a task to do. It's okay, you know, I don't have to be perfect about it. I'm not going to make myself sick about it. There is one big factor into adding to my sentence and or making my sentence shorter. It's called time. It's called what I do with my time. They said time is like a soil. Even Professor Einstein says, you know, time is like a fabric of the universe. Time is like a soil, like an earth. How many seeds every day, how many positive seeds you plant, and how many negative seeds we plant? Again, we are going through chaos in our life because we planted the wrong thing in a past life. So if I planted something wrong, if I said the wrong thing, if I behave in a wrong way, if I thought in a wrong way, now I'm paying for it. So today, right now, what I'm planting? Am I planting happiness, encouragement? Am I smiling? Am I giving love, encouraging people, empowering people? Or am I, you know, planting a seed of sadness and selfishness and worriness and constantly judging, hurting people? So whatever I plant right now, I'm going to have to pay for it later on in the future. So time is very important. How I spend my time. Again, we are in a correction facility. Good behavior is going to free us sooner. Wrong behavior is going to keep us longer. So today I was talking to Susie June. You know, you go visit a sick person. What do you want to plant for him? You want to plant for him positivity, happiness, let's go vacation, I love you, you're so beautiful, you're going to come out of it very soon, you're not sick, you know, you're wonderful. So we are planting positive seeds that it's going to give us a positive fruit to that person and to ourselves. If I go to a sick person and, you know, you feel sorry for him and, you know, there is no hope for you and what a horrible doctor, what a horrible hospital. So you're planting a negative seed for that person and for yourself. You're going to have to pay for it. So either we plant a positive seed and we're going to be done with our correction, or we either keep planting a negative seed and we're going to extend our correction. A sick person that last week we spoke about it in the class that gets miraculously, you know, get healed because keep planting positive seeds into himself. He said, wow, the disease is gone. Where did the disease go? Who cares? But they're planting a positive seed that's going to have a positive fruit. So it's very important, 24/7, what comes out of my mouth, what I think, what I act, I have to be aware what I'm planting. Because good or bad, I'm going to be the beneficiary of it. So it's better to be good. If I'm judging and nervous, I'm worried and annoyed, obviously I'm not cleansing my soul. And guess what? They put you exactly into the situation that you're going to be able to resist it. If I'm not supposed to judge, they're not going to put me in a position to, I don't know, to control somebody else. They're going to put me in a position that they're going to be judging constantly. If my correction is judging, they're going to put me in a position to not to judge. Because how can I correct a wrongdoing? By fixing it. If my issue is judging, I'm done. By being, I don't know, loving, then doesn't do it. I have to stop judging. So there is 3 points. How can I understand? How can I, in Zohar they said to shorten the distance, to understand my past in order to correct my present and future. How can I do it? If I know what I did wrong in the past, so I know how to fix it right now, how can we do it? What is the solution for making the correction shorter time? The chaos is going to go away and the order is going to come to my life. The number one is restriction. Resist, reaction, bring clarity. I repeat. Resist reaction, bring clarity. Resist immediate reaction brings clarity. I get an email, I get a phone call, I get a text, I hear something in the news. The new president decided on something. Wow! I'm going to react to it, I'm going to be so judgmental about it, I'm going to get nervous, I'm going to get annoyed. That's not going to help my correction. I have to wait. I don't react. One of the number one rules of Kabbalah 1 is not to be reactive, but this is the purpose of it. Whatever make me reactive, that's my correction. This Nader in his classes always talk, when we have a bad tooth, the dentist is not here tonight. When we have a bad tooth, the doctor says, when he touched the good tooth, we say, no, no pain. When he touched the bad tooth, he says, oh, I have a pain in that tooth. Yeah, don't touch that tooth. So whatever make you reactive, that's your correction from the past. Whatever makes you reactive. So, you want to be done? We don't want to be done with your chaos, with your sickness, with your issues in your life? Stop reacting to whatever makes you reactive. There is no general rule for it because it's individually to somebody else. You call somebody ugly, become reactive. You know, or you call somebody, I don't know, whatever, or news. So whatever makes you react, that's your correction. That's your issue from the past. So when we stop reacting, it shrink. It shrink the judgment. It shrink the sentence. There is a sentence on all of us. So when I stop reacting, it shrink the sentence. It shortened the how long I have to go through this obstacle, chaos in my life. Give it some time. You hear the bad news, you get the email, you get a text. Give it some time. I promise you, not after one day, you're going to feel better. After 2 days, you're going to feel better. After 3 days, you're going to laugh at it. It's going to be a joke to you. There is a big rule in psychology. It says, choose your wars or fight wisely. So there is a big news about immigration. Wow, I'm going to react, you know. It's not about who cares. Of course we care. But this news is going to go away either way. Who's going to stay with the poison? Who's going to have to spend more time in the correction facility? Me. I'm not saying be passive, I'm not saying, you know, be careless, but don't react. Don't react to anything that happened in your life. You can react in a positive way, in a light way. How can I be the channel of light? How can I, you know, somebody didn't pay the ticket, the entrance fee. So you say, okay, you know, with love and in compassion, you accept it. I'm going to react and be annoyed and nervous and shake about it and get sick about it. So, resisting immediate reaction to whatever push you to your edge, that's your correction in life that's coming from the past life. It's okay if the issue is not resolved. You know, there's a lot of people that have their own issues. Are going to react to somebody else's problem? You know, that's their issue, that's their life. You know, whoever I talk to during the week, they tell me, yeah, somebody has an issue. I said, yeah, help him out, but that's not your issue. Don't bring it to your home, don't bring it to your life. Help him out, but don't make it your issue. Everybody has his own baggage. So, we have to keep reminding ourselves, it's okay. It's okay, it's not going to be resolved. I don't have to have an answer and a solution for everything in my life. It's okay. Bend. You know, I want this obstacle in my life to be over already, enough. How many thousand years are going to carry this chaos in my life? So, each next time I want to react to something, I'm going to remember. By not reacting, I'm going to shorten my sentence. Enough. But I don't want to carry this again and again. That was point number one. Point number two. There is a story in the Zohar, so short in time. It's a beautiful story. We are in book number 10, page number 321, section 99. Please read the next few pages at home. There is a story in a Zohar that there was a princess that she was in love with some regular guy. The princess, she was in a castle of the king, and this regular guy, he was a nobody, and they were in love. And they couldn't see each other, they couldn't talk to each other. So, the only connection they had was the princess, once a day, she find a window, she find a door, she find a balcony, she find a crack in the wall, to look outside. And her lover that used to come around the gate and he used to see her, you know, through the door, through the window, through the crack once a day. That's the only connection they had. Now the Zohar asks, you know, how come he could only see her? How come nobody else? How come the guards, other people, the king, how come nobody else could see the princess showing off her face for a few moments to her lover? How come nobody else saw it? Because the guy was searching for her. Because only that guy was searching for her. He was looking through all the cracks, through all the windows. Maybe she's up there, maybe she's down here. He was hoping for a glimpse to see her. Why I tell you this story? The Zohar compared the princess to the Torah and the Zohar. That we are the lover and the Torah and the Zohar and the Kabbalah is the princess. It shows us a glimpse, it shows us a little bit of a face. We come to a class, we get an idea, but are we searching for it tomorrow again? Are we going to look for it again? Who's going to see the princess? Only the one that keeps searching, keep looking through the cracks, through the window, making an effort. I know, I sat in that chair for 10 years. In the class, it sounds wonderful. On the Shabbat, it sounds wonderful. But honestly, truly, how much you're searching on your free time? How much you're craving? How much you're chasing this wisdom? Over and over, 1 hour a week is okay, 10 hours is wonderful, more than that, wow, you're going to be done with your correction facility very fast. So, how much we are craving, how much we are searching, how much we are chasing this wisdom? The more we invest, the more we learn, the more we add to our wisdom, understanding, knowledge, intelligent, the sooner we're going to be done with our correction. And we're going to have a beautiful, healthy, happy life. So, the reason you are in this class, because you're supposed to study this. It's not by random, it's by order. I know after a year you improved, after a few months we are improving. But we can make it faster. We can make it much faster by investing more. Investing more into study, adding this wisdom. I never talk about religious, I never talk about you doing things. All you have to do is, I'm not talking about rituals, I'm not talking about any religious practice. All I'm asking you is to study, study, study. Add to your wisdom. And spirituality is not only about the class and the kenisa. Spirituality is everyday's life. You think if you go to your business, you can do whatever you want, you can judge, you can... No, you can't. is 24/7. The court, the spiritual court, watching you 24/7. Every night that we sleep, that and our neshama leaves our bodies, going to the court. We're going to cover it with Anel Koach. Every night we are being judged. Every night. Can you imagine? Every night you're being judged. They either add to your sentence, or either they're shortening your sentence. They call it mituk dinim, sweetment of the judgment. So the more positive, the more restriction I do, the more study I do, then the court gonna say, you know what, this guy is doing better. Instead of life sentence, I'm gonna give him 3-year sentence. Next night, wow, what a wonderful, study more, practicing more, restricting more, looking for that beautiful lover that hiding in the books. So every night we have a chance to sweeten our judgment. We don't have time to read this section, but read it at home. Read the each time you feel distance from the Torah, you feel distance from Kabbalah, read this section and look for that page 321.
Section 99.
It's a beautiful story. The third point.
Excuse me, can I ask
a question? Sorry,
how we can be sure that this facility that you said after the next life doesn't come with us? Because we do everything and we are in the order that you said. But after that,
you are doing all your correct thing?
No, but yeah. Anyway, try. How everyone can be sure that the next life doesn't continue?
That's a belief system. That's the emunah. That's the emunah and the belief system that we try to have in this class. There is a... You cannot imagine the order of this universe. You think our country has order? You think our court system has an order? You don't believe how perfect it is in a spiritual system. The third point...
What was the second point in general?
The beautiful lady, the Torah, you know, how much you search.
Desire.
How much desire, how much you crave, how much you chase this wisdom. The more you chase, the more you learn, the more wisdom you have, the sooner you understand what is the issue. We learn in the class that through your astrology, through your portion, you can correct yourself. If you don't have this wisdom, how are you gonna do it? The third point is judging. The name of the portion is judgment, judging. You know, it's again a Kabbalah number one. We don't have the permission, we don't have the right to judge nothing and nobody in our life. We don't have no clue, we don't have no idea what's the story of that person, what is his past life, what is his future life, what is his present life. We don't have the right to judge nothing and nobody. Overjudging is huge in adding to our sentence. Like I said, you know, everybody has his story. A famous guy, a president, he took upon himself to cleanse huge things. I don't have the right to judge him. Or a small person, the smallest guy. We don't see the story. By judging, we are harming ourselves more than anybody else. You know, the president, the senator, the governor, nobody in this classroom is not in your mind. You won't affect him in any way. When we judge, we are damaging ourselves. We are extending the chaos in our life. Overjudging. I know we have to judge, you know, what do I do with my children? Do I punish him? Do I give him a gift? The only judgment that we allow to is coming from the light. I'm judging to see how much light, how much goodness I can create. If I look at the guy and he's needy, okay, I'm judging him, he's needy, right? So I want to provide him something, give him money, give him food, hold his hand. So the only judging that we are allowed to do is with chesed. Thank you very much. With love and kindness. Judging is a planting seed, planting a negative seed. You remember, in the 24 hours of the day, we plant thousands of seeds. We can say, what a horrible life, what a horrible day, what a horrible
weather,
what a sick person, what a brother, what a sister, what a mother, what an economy, what a traffic, wow. Add them up, you know, we planted 1,000 seeds that are going to have to correct it the next day or the next year. But the other way around, beautiful day, gorgeous person, happy class, happy day. My life is full of blessings. I love you, I miss you. So, look at the seeds I'm planting. So we always look at it as a, do I want to extend my correction or I want to shorten it ASAP? The more goodness I do, the more good seeds I plant, the more restriction I do, I shorten it. So overjudging, judging is very harmful because it's totally against the Creator and against my belief system. If I totally believe everything in my life is by design, everything in your life is by design, so who am I to judge? There is a reason, there is a Creator that designed this for all of us. Judging is I'm totally against this belief system. You're against this belief system, you have to deal with more chaos in life. So, and over, I said you have to study your sign, your astrological sign, because your sign tells you your correction. The sign that has the biggest issue with this judging is Virgo. So it's not random. It's not by accident. You know, I'm a Virgo because I have to correct this point of judging. And all of us, we have Virgo. We are all of us this. This judging, you have to stop. So, when I'm judging, it's like I'm 100% into the 1% reality. There is no godliness in me. I forgot totally about the 99%. You remember Kabbalah 1? 1%, 99%. When I'm judging, I'm totally disconnecting myself from the spiritual world. I'm 100% deep into the physical world. And I have to constantly check myself. You know, how much I improved. If I'm not improving, that means I'm totally blocked. I'm not open. I'm not changing my life. I'm not improving. So, make extra effort, put extra time into looking at yourself, you know, how you live your day. Let's get to Ana Bekoach. There is more wisdom, but we are so short in time, I don't want to pass the 1 hour. Every night, our soul go to the court. Every night. How can I sweeten this judgment? So the court, the judge look, okay, this guy has this task. Stop judging, stop reacting, give more love. They go through the list, and they see if you improved. So then, you know, they sweeten the judgment on you. If you didn't improve, and if you cause even more harm, so they extend the chaos in life. So how can we do it? How can we help ourselves? At night time, before I go to sleep, I cover this in a in my classes. Again, you want to look at it as entertainment, you want to have fun with it, that's wonderful. But if you really you bring it down to your life and you tell yourself, you know what, I'm tired of the chaos in my life, I want to put it behind me, so you start practicing it. There is no, if you're waiting for a magic or miracle, there is no such a thing. We had a class that there is a miracle, but you have to connect to your perfect self. You have to connect to your soul. So at night time before we go sleep, we have to have a checklist. What I done today? You know, when you take your car to an oil change, they have this big page, the tire pressure, windshield, you know, oil, brake. Every night before you go to sleep, give yourself another 5 minutes. Make a checklist. What I have done today? Did I judge? Did I was reactive? Did I hurt anybody? Did I give enough love? Was I shining? Was I beautiful today? So you go through your checklist. And it's okay if you've done wrong. That's fine. If we find 5 wrong things, tomorrow make it 4 wrong things. The next day make it 3, 2, 1, 0. And then you say the Shema Yisrael. You say the Shema Yisrael because Shema Yisrael is doing a teshuvah. This court is unbelievable. A child gonna come and flood the whole house, crash your car. He's gonna come and say, "I'm sorry, I'm not gonna do it again." The father gonna forgive that child, right? So Shema Yisrael is a teshuvah. It's like spiritual way to saying, you know, "I'm sorry."
I'm sorry.
It's not gonna happen again. But you have to mean it. You cannot abuse it. And after Shema Yisrael, you say the Ana Bekoach. Ana Bekoach is the force that takes you to the judge. Takes you to the court in a positive way, in a good way. You know, sometimes we have nightmares because our soul doesn't reach that court system. It gets lost, you know, and the negative forces, they attack us. So instead of reaching our Father or the Creator, we get lost. So, because we were so negative that day, we don't even deserve to go to that court system. So that nightmare, because they're attacking us. So by saying the Ana Bekoach is like a speed elevator, it's going to take us to that court in a good way, in a balanced way, in a positive way. And when I do the Ana Bekoach, so Mondays, I mean, we start from Sunday. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. So on the 6 days of the week, on Sunday, when I say the Ana Bekoach, I look at chesed, kindness. How much kindness I can create next Sunday that I didn't create it today. How much bravery on Monday, how much balance and beauty on Tuesday, and so on, you know the rest. On Shabbat, is a very special night. When I do this practice of checkmarking and Shema Yisrael and Ana Bekoach, on Shabbat, I go all the way to Bina. On the 6 days of the week, I have the potential to go to Yesod, Hod, and Netzach, Yosef, Aharon, and Moshe. On Friday night, I have the chance to go all the way to Bina. And the higher I go, the cleanser I become. My soul needs to go to its own gas station to charge up, to purify itself. So, and the dreams are here, and the Bina is the source of light. If I have the zuchut to go to Yosef, then they teach me how to keep doing good and stay away from the bad. If I study the Torah, you know, I go to Yosef. If I act like a Kohen, Aharon and Kohen Gadol. If I act like a Kohen during the day, I have the zuchut to go study with Aharon. If I study the Torah and the Zohar, wow, I have the zuchut to go and see Moshe. Each night that I sleep, there's many levels of academies. It depends how much you purify yourself, you go to a higher academy. So, we passed the 1 hour. To summarize the class, we are here for a purpose. There is a good reason that we are here. Forget about randomness. Throw away the randomness of consciousness from your life. There is a big order. There is a reason I'm here. Cause and effect. I cause something, and now I have to deal with the effect. Either I'm cleansing, you know, something from Adam Rishon or the Noah or Mount Sinai, or I'm cleansing something that I've done. The bigger the challenge is, the bigger your soul, your potential is. So if somebody has a huge challenge, doesn't say, oh, I'm a big victim, bigger victim. No, you are a huge soul. You have a potential to change yourself and change a lot of people. Stop being reactive, more Torah, more Kabbalah, and stop judging, you know, anything, anybody, any situation. Thank you very much. Shabbat Shalom. Have a nice week. See you next week.